thank you all for coming. I'll just kind of sing it.
Good dance.
I need you. It's a slow dance. Cool. So, welcome to IXDA London. Very delighted to be here at RGA today. We saw this space a few months ago, and we were talking with Jen several months back when they were in the previous office, and said, well, maybe we'll hold out until our new office is settled and everything's working, and we can come and talk about the space as well. So actually that was kind of the inspiration for the event tonight. Jen's going to, are you going to do a bit of an intro?
Yeah, just a quick one. So yeah, as Jason said, this is our new space. So we've been here basically since last October, and like, this is awesome to hold lots of people. So it's really good to have you all here today. And the theme, I think, fits to a lot of this space that's being connected and a lot of how that is. So the guys are going to talk about what that means as part of their talk. Just want to do a, there's a few people from IJ here at the back. Christina kind of does all our kind of marketing, I think, and recruitment. So yeah, feel free to chat and things at the end if you want to. And we've got a short little video. If you don't know anything about RGA, just a little bit of our work and some of the stuff that we've done last year to get you. RJ for letting us have the space today. It's been really fun. Thanks to our sponsors, Futureheads, who supply the food and the drink, very importantly. And we have hopefully Nicole, and Nathan here today. Can you put your hands up if you're here at the back? So if you want to talk about hiring or getting a job yourself, definitely try and pick those guys out. And we're experimenting with recording. We're not able to stream this event tonight, but we are trying to sort that out, so for people who can't get tickets, we can have some memory and also kind of include more people in the event, because obviously tickets sell out pretty quickly usually. So big thanks to Futureheads, thank you. So, we have various IXDA announcements, but we don't really have anything this month. We'll just lay it on thick in future events. So on with the show. So Mark and Bandy from RGA.
You have to sit on the front row though.
Alright, so I'm Dan. I'm an associate creative director at RJ. I work mostly with visual design. I specialize in service and product design here, and I've been working with a few different clients in the house. So I did work with Beats on Beats Music, O2 in Priority, McDonald's at Happy Studio, and a few other more. More recently, I've been focusing on connected spaces and helping develop for this space and for a few clients, and I've been working a lot with Mark.
Yeah, I'm Mark, Associate Creative Director from XD. I'm currently working on the Ventures Accelerator program here at RGA, and over the past year I've been working on a few connected space projects as well. So we're going to talk to you about connected spaces and how we're using this building in terms of using it as a sort of, as a prototype, a way to learn and bring value, but also learn sometimes how it does the opposite, and learning how we should kind of apply technology and experiences that are connected to spaces. So these are our capabilities. Connected space projects use a lot of these capabilities. But the more projects like this we've done, the more it's kind of stood out on its own, which is why we now have what we call architecture in here, or how we see architecture.
So one of the conclusions when we're developing our connected space is that today the physical spaces are getting closer to digital experiences. And what that means is that people have an expectation of physical spaces the same as they have with their mobile phones. So they expect the spaces to be a bit more smarter and a bit reactive. So today, if you shop online, you get a much better experience than you go in store sometimes. And I think that expectation is holding true. So the idea is we need to make physical spaces interesting again to make sure people just don't shop better, but they get to work or they do go to libraries and they have a better time in real life. So the way we view connected spaces is a convergence of information, architecture, and technology. We see it as an emerging field, so whenever we talk about it, we know there are different companies, and there are architecture companies approaching it, technology companies approaching it, design companies like us also approaching it, and everyone seems to have a different process and approach to it. But what's interesting to us is that a lot of what we learned about service design is to applicable to connected spaces. So our experience as designers is very important, and it helped us develop quite quickly. The idea of connecting information, architecture, and technology is that you can use it to reinvent what offices and physical environments can be. I think initially there's a focus on offices because of bigger budgets and more will to experiment, but we see this as just a start, and we know this is going to go everywhere. And we know that because a few years ago we started seeing this with homes, so we've seen thermostats and lights and everything that seems to be connected. But what was missing a few years ago was the conversation those objects would have with each other. So you had a thermostat that wouldn't talk to your lights, that wouldn't talk to your alarm. And we've seen that more recently they started to become closer and closer together. So this is one of the things that is changing, but also hotels are becoming more welcoming, and that means not just the way you check in and check out, but we've also been developing ways that the environment of the hotel can help you find good places to go out for dinner, or if you're only in town for a night, it can drive you to the best places or the best cocktail bars and so on, as well as reminding you if you forgot something plugged in your bedroom before you leave. We're seeing with offices that are becoming more collaborative, and that means two things. One is we're trying to design the space more and more to make sure people, when they are in there, they get to talk to each other. So a lot of this space is being designed and changed to create those contacts, as well as we're trying to provide a better experience for remote working. With gyms, we've seen the data driving a lot of sports with Nike Plus, Strava, and all the similar apps, and we know the tracking is big, but now we're trying to look at how this tracking can influence the experience you have in the gym itself. We started doing work with a client called Equinox on that, but we know that this would span out of rooms to actually complete gyms. Stores are becoming more personalized, so we are seeing how mobile can drive customization or can drive one-to-one communication in retail. As well, libraries becoming more relevant. It's quite interesting how libraries are changing with the idea of co-working or more remote workers. Libraries are becoming a for the aggregate. So with that increase of visits in libraries, we're wondering how can we make sure people get to enjoy the content that's all in there. And we all know libraries are quite hard to browse sometimes. Museums is a space that's very interesting to us as well, because we know the experience in the museums could be much, much better. And we know we can do that with connected spaces, with things being more context aware, rather than you having a device where you need to type a number as you walk around. Stadiums, I think entertainment is a big field, and I think there's a lot of investment there. So Levi's Stadium in the US delivers content in real time to 75,000 fans, only if they are there and if they're logged in, and they can extend the experience, so they can order food, order seats, and we know that will be a very fertile ground. And last, theme parks are becoming more sophisticated. So we've seen Disney investing loads and loads of money to make sure that they have connected devices and spaces, because they can reduce the queue in the restaurants, they can reduce the queues in the attractions, and that works twofold. So they can make more money out of it, but they can also provide a much better customer experience. So last year, about a year and a half ago, we moved to New York, but this was our first connected space. Before that, we were talking a lot about how connected spaces could actually make environments much better. But before we could actually go and talk to anyone about it, we had to prove it by ourselves. Thing with New York is we learned a lot about how you develop connected spaces. We had to test a lot of technologies. Some failed drastically, and we're slowly phasing them out. But I think the key learning was that we had to provide an ambient where you could quickly replace technology because of the short lifespan of technology versus a long lifespan of a building. And last year, we've moved to this space in London. Oh yeah, and of course, we made a movie about it. So there's a movie called Workplace. It's available for free at rj.com. So if you're interested on learning more about how we developed the New York building, working with Foster and Cohen and so on, there's a lot of good content in there. It's worth watching. So in 2016, we moved to this building, and Mark could give you a bit more detail about it.
Cool, yeah. So this is the second connected office in the network, and we're rolling out into other offices as well, of varying scale. So as Dan kind of pointed out, we took many learnings from New York, being the first one in terms of how it succeeded, and also, importantly, its failures. And we had to adapt and choose what they've done and apply it here. And we had to work out what fitted us in terms of the time we had to do those kind of things, our budget, but also importantly our culture and our needs, really. And so that really has created a space that we see as being kind of a beta, especially at the moment, because we haven't been here that long yet. So it's full of prototypes, some which we'll show you later on. And we're already seeing that some of those are working for us and some aren't, for different reasons. Now, as we were kind of picking what we had to do, we always had to consider these three things. The things that we kind of did in the space had to be around recruitment, retention, and revenue, and how we can use experiences and technology and services to really help those things, to help the company, to help us succeed. And from that, we brought over these five principles, which were started in New York, and they're things that have then kind of helped us to decide what to make. And so going into these in a little bit more detail, so productivity, we needed to make a space that was obviously easy to work in and enjoyable to work in as well. And that goes everything from the materials such as these panels on the ceilings to the floor to help acoustics, to the kind of furniture that we have, such as the sit-stand desks, and even the kind of tools we have at reception, such as a way to let hosts know when guests have arrived and things like that. The second is flexibility. So we needed a space that could adapt to our needs, either instantaneously or over time as we learn more about how we need to use this space. And that's everything from fun stuff, like in New York, they can change the color of lights, it's just quite whimsical, through to having rooms where you can adapt them depending on what kind of furniture you need in the space or what kind of technology at the time, and also the kind of controls you can have in there for things like the lighting. And something that's really important is collaboration. So in New York, the office is massive. It's something like two American football pitches in size, but it's over two floors, which is quite rare in New York to get a space like that. And when they got it, it was a shell, so we could kind of do what we wanted. So through a huge staircase in the middle to allow for friendly collisions, in effect, to make it easier to bump into people, because they've got a lot more people than we have in this office. So it was just a way to help people to like physically bump into someone, like, oh yeah, I need to talk to you about this thing, or to meet new people and things like that. Now, when we moved in here, we didn't have that luxury. We couldn't rip out the building to that level. So we've had to look at, well, how do we create tools that allow us to collaborate in different ways, so using technology such as beacons to allow us to then use location services to maybe find out where people are, or even things like we're looking at the moment and how we can kind of suggest maybe meeting new people based on particular interests and things like that. And the next one is storytelling. Now, storytelling, it's just really important to have a space that kind of communicates who we are. And that's communicating it to existing and new clients, to people like yourselves when you visit, to new hires as well, and also even to ourselves, like when we're here day to day, just to remind ourselves this is the kind of work that we're making, this is kind of what we're doing. And one learning that we've had from that as well is to consider, well, it's great having screens like this around, but what's going to appear there and how do you sort of make sure it doesn't appear repetitive? What kind of content is valuable and can show you the kind of things that we're doing? Again, through things like prototyping. And here's some examples of screens.
So a lot of people mention that when they walk in, they feel a bit like an airport, and that's the reason. All the signage in the building, it was so inspired by airports, especially for New York, because of the size of the building. You need to be able to look across 200, 300 meters and figure out where you should go. The crane just went up, back. The key thing for us was also to make sure, as I mentioned before, the idea of assimilating digital and physical spaces. So every experience you have with RJ, be it our physical signage, the screens, the website, the app, which is changing to be not just client-facing, but employee-facing. We want to make sure the experience is the same. And now we're also wondering how we take the experience further, and we extend the experience of a connected space to people who are not in the space, so using either voice technology or chat technology or something like that.
And also inspiration is another thing. So we want it to be a place that gets the best out of people. So we're doing what a lot of agencies do, obviously. We stick the awards we've won around so that people can kind of see what we're doing. It's obviously great for clients as well as for us. But something else that they do in New York is that Bob's a big collector of outside art. So they have that around, which obviously gives a bit of life to an otherwise kind of quite like white space. And here what we've done is we've scattered around different kind of objects on the floors. And those objects are things that we just think of like really well designed. And they've been a really good talking point, especially when they were first being put out. People were still kind of saying, well, why is this cup here? Like, why is this kind of particular phone here? So it's been a great thing to even just kind of get people talking about good design.
So to Mark's point, I think the thing we're learning with quick prototyping is initially we were spending a lot of time trying to develop technology and then trying to develop things to be scalable and so on. What we learned is faster is better, so now we're trying to move to use more out-of-the-box technology whenever we can. It doesn't necessarily need to be the latest tech. As soon as we understand there is a need, or we create an idea that there is a need, we figure out what's the quickest way to test it. Sometimes it means using a technology that's real, sometimes it means faking it, so people just interact with that and you can take it from there. The idea is, if we do prototypes internally, we can get something running in a few days to a week, or maximum a couple of weeks, and we can learn from there. A few things we show today have been developed that way, and it allows to refocus, because every time we start developing something, we have a lot of ideas. But it's the cool thing about prototyping is you need to have a very narrow focus or you don't get it done in time. And the other thing is, when you prototype, then you have something that you can show to your clients, you can show to the other offices, and then you can span across the network. So one of the things we did was the chatbot. I know everyone is talking about chatbots and conversations and so on. We tried to not do something very smart with it, if you will. We tried to focus on doing one thing at a time. The first thing we wanted to solve was booking meeting rooms. And then a lot of work we did with clients, it seems to be a massive issue. Outlook doesn't work well, Exchange doesn't work well. And we realized that you can cut down the time of booking a meeting room quite drastically by just allowing people to do it via text. And you can also add a bit of warmth and tone of voice to that. The other thing we did was fix the signage. The idea for it's not so much for this office, but for New York as well, where you can look around. You never know which rooms are booked and which ones aren't. We signed that by having, you know, black or white screens, black being booked. If you walk into a room, you can see who's booked, who booked that room. So if it's empty, you can chase that person to ask to take it. That idea is not supposed to end there. What we want to develop that further is to start adding sensors or trying to understand if there are people using the room. And from there, you know, if someone booked a room and it's not there in the first 5 minutes, it should release to everyone else in the office. The idea that you will have as many meetings and meeting rooms you have, it's very true. So if we can make the rooms flow better and be always free, that's good. And then the other thing is this fixing signage and fixing meeting rooms and all those tiny things are about marginal improvements. There is a guy called Dave Brailsford. He is the coach that won the Tour de France with a British team for the first time ever. And he was all about marginal improvements. He said, you know, if I can make my team do everything 100% better, we can win. And I think that applies a lot for connected spaces. It's not the shiny new thing, but it's a combination of tiny improvements you can make. The other thing we realized when we moved in is because of the amount of screens, as Mark mentioned, it all became a little bit cold and the content feels repetitive and doesn't feel dynamic enough. So we started working on how can we use music or how can we use passion points to add a little bit more warmth and character to the space. We've been working on a few prototypes on allowing people to post pictures to the screens, allowing them to vote on which pub we should go on Fridays, and so on and so forth. The one we developed further is music. It allows us to connect the Spotify accounts from everyone in the office and then analyze how happy their music is, the BPM, and so on. And the cool thing is from there you can compare by departments. You can see which department likes dancing music versus which department likes sad music, if you will. And you can get by clients, you can see which client teams are more stressed and less stressed based on the BPM. So I think there's a lot of interesting insights you can get in data based on the music people are listening over time, and it's a more human way. Next, we started to prototype this, so that's how it looks at the moment. That's one the first thing we learned is people don't really know what this means. So we're adding labels to it, so that's the next update. We'll have a few more labels that explain how this means, but the idea is you get a quick overview. So this is the whole visual department, and you can see, you know, the different blocks are based on data you get from Spotify, which is called danceability, liveness, tempo, and things like that. You can visualize, and then you can also look for every user, so you can see the top song, the minutes listened, and saved songs, and you're gonna expand that to different groups. And start having a little bit more fun. And then there's the app.
So the app we built, we've had two versions of the app so far. Now the first one was very kind of client and partner focused. So it was something that kind of helps people that come here to learn who we are, what we do, look at case studies and capabilities. So ultimately it was kind of another sales tool. There was some interesting technology in there. So again, we use beacons to look at location, to maybe throw certain content at people depending on their route through the building, as it can maybe tell you what particular teams are working in a certain area, for example. But if we're truthful, it was when we kind of made it didn't have much traction. You know, a lot of clients said, well, why would I do that? I have client services and new business that would kind of show me a lot of these case studies and things. I have people that give me one-to-one conversations when I'm walking through a space. So it wasn't really used that much, which shouldn't really come as much of a surprise. Sorry. But then what we created was the second version, which kind of moved it from client to employee focus. It was really about creating something that was more of a utility. And that meant that visually it changed, so the navigation structure changed and it had to support new features. So now it can do things like booking new meeting rooms, finding people so that you can contact them, and also still they learn about case studies and capabilities, so it kind of takes you out of the bubble that you're in maybe sometimes and look at what else is going on in the building. again, we're still seeing kind of like slow uptake, but I think the next thing that we kind of really need to work on with it is the onboarding for people, whether that's new hires, so that when they come, it's maybe part of their onboarding into becoming an RGA, someone who works at RGA. And then for those people that are already here, what ways do we actually maybe build a campaign using the space and using the screens to actually get people to use it and to then use that data in terms of what kind of things that they're actually using it for, and then develop it over time. And so then there's the RGA bot.
So the RGA bot, as I mentioned, it can be used for to book meeting rooms. I think the whole goal was not to try and rebuild Siri or Alexa or something very smart. It's really to focus on a few needs we saw emerging when we moved here. One of them is booking a meeting. With the company growing a lot, the second need is getting more info. It's very hard to know who's working with you and who's around you, and some people are really shy to ask. So on RGA bot, you can ask on other employees, and it gives you how long they've been here, where they see their contacts, which clients they worked on. So it gives you a brief overview. So on day one, you can just start researching your team. Now, the next step, as Mark mentioned, is allowing you to connect with people that might have similar interests to you. So this becomes not a tool just to discover more about people, but discover what they have in common with you to allow for easier onboarding. There's other things we're trying to do with wayfinding, allowing you to ask questions. For instance, if you go from London to the New York office, you might have a few questions and you don't want to annoy everyone asking for directions. You might do that via a bot. And there are other things, if you ever have to fill a timesheet or if you ever got an email about asking you to fill a timesheet, that's something we're trying to move to a bot because people seem to react much better to a conversation interface rather than an angry email. So the thing we learned after moving here is first thing is you add a lot of screens to the space, and then next thing you're trying to do is make sure you use all the screens you have available. But I think the issue we're starting to face is everything became around the screens, and we lost a little bit the focus on the architecture or how to use the space better. So the what we're trying to prototype now is how can you make the interface or the way you interact with the building more invisible and make sure that the building can react to you. So we've been experimenting with Listener. So Listener delivers audio via an audible signal, so you can listen to anything that's on the screens playing on your phone, almost in sync. We're trying to use Alexa to allow you to ask for specific case studies. So if you are with a client in this room, you can just talk to Alexa and ask her to play a Nike video, for instance. But also, we're trying to experiment with sensors to allow everyone to find the quietest places in the building, the noisiest places in the building, how to make sure that the room sets a temperature based on how many people are using it at the same time, or based on the preference of the meeting owner and things like that. So the idea is, now that we have all the screens, it's like, how can we make sure that we use them less, or whenever they use them, they're a little bit more meaningful. To do all of that, we're discovering a lot of stuff from data. We try to track as much as we can how people are using the building. So we want to understand what the flow areas are, so where people are walking by, as well as dwelling areas, because that allows us to define the building better. So we've been changing the floor layout quite a bit since we moved in based on that, trying to move the sofas around, make sure places that have a lot of flow get a bit quieter, places that are not being used are used more often, because the idea is you can upgrade the space, if you will, without necessarily having to invest in new furniture and new tech. The idea, the thing I find really nice about this is that it allows us to face a building like you would face a service or a product, so you can actively do many, many versions of it without necessarily having to move to a new building every time, which is not very practical. And then I think the other thing we get from data is which behaviors are emerging. So are people working a lot on sofas? So if they are doing that, do we need all those desks, or can we reduce the number of desks and be more about hot desking? And we've been only here for a year, so it's very hard to get a lot of conclusions from that. But the idea is over time, you should be able to use that data to inform more your decisions.
Cool. And so lastly, although we can't talk about the kind of client projects, the connected space projects we've been working on, but there is one kind of key learning that I did want to share. I think that what we realized is it's not just about kind of designing for different kind of screens, and it's not even only about designing for the building, because it's, you have to think about that end-to-end journey and what people are doing before they come in the building and after it. And we've realized that depending on what kind of a space it is and what the client's needs are and what the user's needs are, that you can really start to explore everything from if they're visiting and they're in an airport and they're coming through to if it's coming to another space like an office, what kind of information could you use? How else can you use the data to help them sort of onboarding for their time in the building as well? So I think that, yeah, in summary for us, it's kind of almost thinking beyond the building as well. So thank you very much. We're open to...
Any questions or comments?
Hello, my name is Michael. I'm a technologist and design strategist with Foster & Partners, the architect who did the New York office. So, hello. And I'm curious with this is that with what's going on with connected environments, we're starting to do a lot of this ourselves because we find it incredibly important to let buildings adapt over time and use technology in a way where because obviously when you're building a workplace, they can take 3, 4, 5 years to build. And you know, to see that far in the future is quite difficult. So my question is really is, when you start prototyping these new tools and when you bring the technologies in, how do you test them or how do you get feedback on them other than just the data usage? Do you have any qualitative approach to getting data about how people are feeling about them or driving the next steps for new tools to develop?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, actually, I think something that we've got to chap in the remote who's interning with us, Dan, who's doing just that. So he's looking at different kind of services that he can use. And with that, he's doing interviews and stuff for either the key stakeholders or the people that would be the users to work out what is the right thing to do. So it's definitely something that you can do. Even with some other projects, where possible, we're sending out questionnaires to people and getting as much information as we can to kind of give us an understanding as you would any other project. So yeah, really the kind of things that you would do as an experienced designer, you do with this project, these kind of projects as well anyway.
And I think the other thing is we have a lab in the office here, so you can have an idea of sensors of multiple screens or VR, anything, you can go and test it there. So you sit down and you try a few things, and then if you feel it's working, then you might bring someone in and ask questions. So you can get a general idea. It's more qualitative anyway, because we don't have that many people to get a better survey, but we do test all of that. We've been experimenting a little bit with VR as well, depending on the scale of the project. How can we use VR to present an architecture idea?
I think scale is a really important point. It's like every other project and prototype, so what kind of prototype can we make with our time and budget? And so then if it's literally paper prototyping, showing people in corridor testing, then that can still give you insight to kind of drive you down the path you need.
Yeah, kind of off back of that question, sort of how frustrating is it as people who work primarily with digital technologies previously, is it to kind of work with some of those more fixed things? Have you had to...
What do you mean by fixed?
So like, I mean, you've got some fixed physical spaces, some fixed devices essentially.
Yeah.
Like, have you hit walls around those as constraints yet?
I think there's nothing that I'd say has been that frustrating, but it's just been learning curves, I guess, in terms of working out. Well, obviously buildings have to be built in a certain way, and things have to happen in a certain way. And I guess it's making sure that, say for example, if it's something that's being fitted out, you've got the fitters, but it's collaborating with them. It's really important that there's other people that are making this thing other than what we normally do. So it's like working with that guy, basically. And it's just making sure that you have those conversations and that you're working with each other as much as possible. So with some projects, depending on where it's been and what time we've been brought on, we've been able to sort of work with them on, actually, maybe that's in the wrong place. Maybe think about putting that there, because then you can do X, Y, or Z things. So I think it's just making sure that you're having those conversations with people that are doing things that otherwise might be alien to you or just not within your normal remit.
I think in terms of constraints, one thing we learned is there is a lot more disciplines or a lot more people required in a flow. So for some clients, we suggested what would be the perfect flow for like someone walking into the building, having experience and leaving. But then there are security concerns, there are facilities concerns. So you start bringing all the other people and departments within the equation, and it doesn't become a problem for the architects, you know, UX, visual, tech. You start bringing facilities, and you bring security, and you bring, you know, pretty much everyone that would be involved. Because sometimes you have a nice idea, like as an example, you press a button and you get a coffee delivered to your desk. Great idea, but then it affects so many people in the process. So I think that was, to me, was the biggest learning curve. It's like you need to really think down everyone that will be affected by every single decision.
Just want to ask about, I'm working on a project with a client, also on onboarding things, and so we're looking at Slackbox and the like, and on the one hand, we're looking at sort of optimizing, making them as independent as possible, right, so that they don't have to ask people things. But on the other hand, I start to wonder about how that impacts culture, and what kind of impression that makes on people when they join the organization. Because it kind of start creating a culture of like, are you, you know, just look on Slack or look on whatever, you know, and sort it out yourself, and rather than actually speaking with your colleagues. So I don't know, is that something that you guys
speaking as someone that's been a user of them, I guess
yeah.
that it's not, it's more been at times where it's easier for me to use that channel rather than speaking to someone, I've done that. So, and so things like, yeah, say booking a meeting room, a lot of the time it's like, God, I actually need one really quickly, Slack, I can do it really quickly, rather than using Outlook or, you know, if it's about finding out who a person is, sometimes it's just easier to use it. So I'd say it's actually, it's another channel that allows the person to think about what's the best way for me to do this thing, whether that's like either a one-to-one conversation or actually using a Slack bot. So I haven't noticed that, and I haven't noticed anyone just kind of like brushing people up and say, "I'll just use that tool." I haven't seen that happen.
I think the key thing for Slack is we're not trying to design it to be human. So it's very clear you're talking to a bot. We're not trying to do like a lot of channels. Fake it, you are a fake human and try to make jokes. We do a little bit, you know, we need to be funnier than just using Outlook, but we don't fake it as a person. I mean, it's very systematic, it's very about getting to an end result and providing the user options rather than asking the user to type. So we try to make that barrier, it's like that's a bot, and we don't try to make it sound otherwise.
Yeah. And another thing is that one of the reasons why we focused on Slack is because it had such big uptake within the agency already, which helps. So it was something that people were already using. And also it's a place that people, it's a tool for conversations between people. So it's just another service that is within those conversations with actual people. So I think that's why it kind of works.
Have you taken any of your ideas home?
I have, not from the RGA stuff, but there are some ventures, things that are kind of like this where I've kind of taken certain things home, which I probably shouldn't talk about, but that are kind of fun. So I think that, again, like if I kind of come back to the thing I was talking about with kind of going beyond the building and the app, it'll be interesting to start to see as it's built out and we work out what things are people liking using for, and with the Slack bot, what services could be built out that are right for that. But another thing on that though that we kind of realized, and again on kind of like more client projects, was obviously there's a time and a place to have conversations or to give, like to do these kind of things, but there's also you need that kind of space. So as a work environment, yeah, people obviously need tools to use at home, but maybe you also need that kind of breathing space from it. So maybe it's a bit early days for us all to start doing it.
Hi, my name is Phil, and I came from another talk just now from Foster and Partner who built a new office where I'm going to work. And this building is so big, they're making an app for the people who work there to find, you know, their desk and the toilets and all the necessary stuff. So it seems like really in the future buildings have apps. So you mentioned you're going to collect data about flows and you know where people huddle. But what kind of learnings do you take from that data? Like what can you possibly do with that data?
So a few things are helping with maintenance, so we know which rooms are being more used and less used, and that affects how you change the lights, get a computer checked, and so on. I think the key thing to capture data for us is to understand if there is one area of the building that's not being very used, and then we can start asking questions on why it's not being very used and if there's anything we can do to make better use of the space. We learned, I think, in our old office, some areas are very quiet and some areas are incredibly busy, and things didn't tend to change unless, you know, some client moved to a different floor. And I think we're trying to focus on this building. It feels a lot more balanced, the amount of activity you get per floor, excluding you have one floor, it's only meeting rooms, so it tends to be quieter, and a lot of people go there for silent work. But in general, it's more balanced. The other thing is where, you know, you put the sofas in break rooms, they have, you know, most of them are close to the lifts, and now we're starting to bring them inside the office as well, because some parts are getting either too quiet or just too much, too busy because they're only desks.
How do you deal with music? What's the policy around music, and how do you manage music in the building?
I don't think there's someone plays music.
Everywhere I've been, there's always been some form of argument around it, like either the volume or the style of it.
Well, that's what this is for, I guess, in a sense as well. So obviously, yeah, you can't always control it. People turn it up loud enough, you're going to hear it. But really, considering that all the floors are open plan, if someone's playing music, unless it's like right next to you, it is kind of like muffled to a point anyway.
Yeah.
But then there are obviously those scenarios sometimes where people just play louder and louder to try and fight. there's no kind of rules for it.
I think with these floors, they're really good at,
yeah,
at what, it, keeping the sound quite low. So if someone is meters away from you, you don't really get annoyed by the music, unless it's some really bad music. There's no escape. But in general, it's quite good. But we don't have like a central place where people can choose to suggest music and so on.
We tried it with the cafe actually on the ground floor, and it didn't really work. There just wasn't uptake. So we created like a Spotify playlist that everyone could collaborate with. So like it just became one that the staff use, but then it's like, well, they're the ones that have got to listen to it all the time, not people that are going down for a coffee for a few minutes and disappearing.
Mm-hmm.
So let them control the music, it stops them from going mad. Or
someone put a whole Slayer album there. It's not very good for the mood.
I think the only thing they were told is no swear words. Obviously, they have to be careful with swear words, just because they're close to receptions. Apart from that, it's free for all.
I was just thinking about how much of it is like an ambient thing where it just adapts as you're moving through the space versus you expect somebody to interact with the thing. And I think chatbots and all that are such an emergent thing still, that like encouraging that type of behavior must be challenging. And I'm just wondering if you've got any thoughts around how maybe it's onboarding or something, or how, I mean, the prototype might test well, but will people actually take the time to learn the interface to use it? I mean, there's a lot of other things at play, right?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, I think just back to how I ended up using the RGA bot, it's just been through actually discovering the tools that are in there. So I think there is some work that we need to do on that side of it yet. But I think, again, it's because it's quite early days for us in implementing them that we haven't kind of thought about that side of it. But it's definitely something that I think that we need to consider, is actually getting people to, or just reminding people a few times of how to use them.
I think, uptake is the biggest issue, right, with this lag bot. Use it two or three times, you never go back to using Outlook. But otherwise, it's very hard. If people who are used to Outlook, they always go there first, and then get frustrated and then go to Slackbot. So we haven't figured out yet how to change this, so they go straight to Slackbot.
I mean, for me, I think something that I do kind of want to suggest is that we do things like campaigns on the sprints to remind people of the prototypes a bit more. I don't think that we're doing that enough yet. I mean, we do try and have some stuff kind of around the space to get people to play around with things and to remind people, but I think that maybe we need to be a bit more strategic about how we kind of keep talking about certain things and kind of thinking a bit on the test and go, okay, did even exposing it on the screens work, and has there been an uptake, and okay, has it continued? I think there is stuff that you should do, and again, use the space to do it.
Is that part of your strategy when you're dealing with clients, that like if you are rolling out something like this, there must be some sort of, you know, 90-day plan or 6-month plan or whatever to help see the change in behaviour and adoption and things like that? Because I imagine the project would live and breathe on whether people use, right?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, we definitely, with these kind of projects, we definitely say that this isn't something that we want to just hand over and leave. We want to kind of be involved in iteration as well. So we do kind of try to make sure that the right stakeholders are thinking about that and how they should, like, how data and use it. And and make sure they can iterate.
Yeah, with the bot, we've seen that it takes about 1/10 of the time it would take on Outlook. So that's, you know, for 10 minutes, you're saving 9 minutes pretty much when you use Slack bot versus Outlook. Over, you know, 2,000 employees in a year, that's a lot of money saved for the agency. That's a lot more work or more value provided to the clients.
Mm-hmm.
And then when you have that data, it's quite easy to go and sell that to someone. It's like, you must implement that. You must change your systems to afford for that, because it's going to make an impact on your business. So when we have those arguments, it's always easy with prototypes. Not always you get this much uptake, or not, you don't get these numbers so easily.
Yeah. I think so. Something else we've noticed though is that, because obviously we're a global agency, the kind of clients and stuff we have are global, you always have to think about the culture as well. So one thing, even with the kind of data that you have that might be right, you still have to think about, okay, but is this still appropriate for culturally how people may behave in this kind of space in another part of the world? And so I think data does really work, but you also have to still kind of do a lot of the kind of the things we were talking about earlier to work out, well, is this still the right kind of service, or is there another way that we have to do it, or how do we have to adapt it?
I think data has been really good to help improve features and help drive the right in the right direction, but a lot of those things can come down to culture and a little bit of gut feeling. I think that's I don't think you can get everything, all the insights you need through data.
Which doesn't tell you why, right?
Because if we could get do all through data, then we would be out of a job quite quickly. So I think there's just a little bit of design feeling in there, and then you improve with data.
Cool. Well, I'm going to stop it there for the moment. If you want to speak with the guys, then capture in the break. But thank you so much for that.